wanted to look at is how these different methods of monitoring potentially affect reproductive rates of kestrels, and then also how is the population doing in terms of reproduction overall. You know, we're in a fruit growing region, there's things like pesticides, people, growers driving around, harvesting, is that potentially disturbing the kestrels? And so what I found is that there was no evidence that our differing monitoring methods was affecting kestrel reproductive success. As John said earlier, they are very tolerant of human sort of intervention and checking of the boxes, and this our results seem to support that. And so overall, for all of our new nest boxes, we've seen very high occupancy and high reproductive rates. And so for the past 3 years, or 2013 to 2015, 93% of our boxes have been occupied with a mean nesting success of 91%, and productivity has been high as well. So over those 3 years, the mean clutch size has been close to 5, 93% of those eggs hatch, 91% of those young fledge. So good reproductive rates for this region. So then, as we talked about then in with Chris's talk, how to look at the sort of regional or the landscape level activity of kestrels. So we know they're occupying the boxes at high rates, but are the boxes providing additional nest sites for them? Are they actually nest site limited? And so to look at this, I conducted roadside transect surveys across these four roads highlighted in this map on Leelanau and Mission Peninsulas. And so each of these transects were divided into these 1.6 kilometer segments. So there's a total of 28 segments all across the county. And each of these markers represents boxes, and the colors represent when they were installed. So some boxes were installed 2012, or those earlier boxes. Some were installed fall 2013, and some were installed as late as fall 2015. So notice that this Western transect didn't have any Cresco boxes within 800 meters of this transect until 2015. And so I surveyed these segments repeatedly every summer in order to determine if kestrels were present at each segment each year, and to see how those dynamics changed as the years progressed and as we added more boxes. And so what I found from my statistical modeling is that there was a strong relationship between the presence of a box at a site and the presence of kestrels at a site. And to visualize this then, this red line here shows the number of sites, so those number of segments that had boxes, and then in the black here is the number of sites that were occupied by kestrels. And so as you can see, between 2013 and 2016, as we installed more boxes, more of those sites now have boxes. And as a result, our model estimated that the number of sites with kestrels has increased as well. So then, we've seen that these kestrels are occupying our new boxes at high rates. They seem to be increasing the presence of kestrels in the region, and therefore they're likely spending time in and around the orchards and could have agricultural benefits for the farmers on whose properties these boxes are installed. And so then, looking then from that angle, the first goal was to quantify the prey removal by kestrels. So what are kestrels taking out of this region as they provision their young? And so how we did this is using those externally installed kestrel cameras. Yes, yeah, so we're going to try to show you. Yeah, so there's an example of an adult male delivering. Here he comes. Delivering a meadow bowl. Okay, thank you. So as a result from watching this video and collecting prey remains from the boxes, we found that kestrels do consume a number of different orchard pest species. So among arthropods, they consume grasshoppers, which are known to damage particularly young trees by eating the leaves, rodents, as you've seen, so meadow voles, deer mice, And they also take birds as well, including known pest species like European starlings and American robins. And these were examples of bird remains taken from the nest boxes. And so then we used that camera data to quantify how many different deliveries are made, so how many individuals of different prey types are removed throughout the season. And so this is a subset of our data for 8 different boxes over 3 years, and each bar represents 2 randomly chosen days from the breeding season. So overall, generally speaking, the most common prey type in terms of number are the arthropods in green, followed by the mammals in red, and then birds in blue, and then occasional mollusks, annelids, so earthworms, and then amphibians and reptiles, very occasional. But as you can see, looking, there is quite a bit of variation, especially in these red mammal bars. So the number of mammals delivered varies between boxes, it varies between years, and these are just a couple samplings of different days, so it also varies, of course, between days throughout the season. And so we're using then this camera data to analyze and find factors that affect how many of these different prey types are removed. In particular, we're interested in this variation in number of mammal deliveries. So things like, how does weather affect it, the age of the nestlings, and then landscape characteristics. How do they all relate? And then can we use that to develop models that would help us predict for a given box how many mammals would we expect that kestrel pair to remove over the course of the season? And so then I mentioned landscape or habitat influence in that. And one way we're exploring those factors is by looking at landscape or habitat features from where these kestrels are spending their time. And so what we've done for the past 2 summers is put these GPS data loggers on some females in order to track, as you can see here, their sort of fine temporal scale and spatial scale movements. So over the course of a couple days, where does she go, where does she spend her time, and sort of identifying hot spots of activity that could inform what sort of habitat characteristics, things like, you know, this open pasture here, would that be a useful variable to include in a model to determine, for example, if she's bringing a lot of voles from this time, are voles related to the presence of that pasture there? And so then finally, of course, what the growers are most interested in is not only how many prey are being removed, but does that really have an effect on how many prey are left over in their orchards? And so we focused on the effects of these nesting kestrels on the abundances of the fruit-eating birds, because they are sort of the most direct impact on the growers, because they consume the fruit themselves. So our hypothesis then is that, the most obvious case is that kestrels could reduce fruit-eating bird abundances by capturing and removing birds from the region, so a direct effect. And so we do know that they take birds, and they do take things like robins and starlings. But as you might have noticed from that graph of the different proportions, they really don't take that many birds compared to small mammals and certainly insects. And so you might think then, well, it's unlikely they're going to reduce bird populations just by eating birds. And that is likely the case. But the other part of the hypothesis is that kestrels, in addition to consuming birds, could also be deterring them, because their boxes could act as a cue of predation risk for those birds. And so we have these boxes installed in the orchards. The adults are making deliveries all throughout the breeding season. The female hangs out at the box a lot. They're very noisy. They talk to each other. The female talks to the nestlings in the box. And eventually the nestlings are loud enough that they come to the door and they make a lot of noise too. And so all of these things could be a reliable cue to prey birds that, oh, there's raptors that live here and they're always here. We might want to avoid this area. And so the prediction then is that orchards with an active kestrel box, so an actively raised nest, would have lower fruit-eating bird abundances than those without, and in this case, I defined without as no active kestrel nest within a mile of that orchard. So very unlikely that any kestrels are spending a significant amount of time there. And so what I did is some modeling of counts of prey birds in the orchard. So I did it in two groups of fruit-eating birds. So the small fruit-eating birds, which are things like cedar waxwings, Baltimore oriole, rose-breasted grosbeak, and then the medium-sized fruit-eating birds, which are the robins, grackles, starlings, blue jays. And so what I found is when I built these models that accounted for things like the different orchard, the different year, once you take that variation out of the equation, there is significant effects of having an active kestrel nest on the abundances of both the small and the medium fruit-eating birds. And so to visualize this, I pooled both fruit-eating groups together. So these are all the fruit-eating birds. So the mean number of fruit-eating birds for both sweet cherry and tart cherry crops. And for both crops, there is significant reduction at sites that have an active kestrel nest as opposed to sites without. And so then just a couple of take-home messages. So as I said at the beginning, we've had really good response to these new boxes that we put up, high occupancy rates, high reproductive success, and they seem to be very tolerant of the various monitoring techniques that we've been using the past couple of years. And also, as I've seen from my roadside surveys, it seems like this population is or was nest site limited. And by providing more boxes, we have increased the presence of kestrels in this region. And again, from the video data, we've seen that kestrels do consume various orchard pests, but again, they do so in varying degrees based on potentially a number of factors that we're looking into. And then finally, fruit-eating bird abundances are lowered at sites with active kestrel nests. And so then, briefly, some of the ongoing and future work we're looking at. Again, as I mentioned, we're trying to build these models of kestrel predation of rodents to try to predict how many rodents we would expect a kestrel pair to remove in a season. And we've also done some measuring of the actual rodent activity in orchards, which has proven to be a bit tricky at times. Apparently, voles are a lot harder to catch than you would think based on how many the kestrels catch. So that's an ongoing and potentially another graduate student's project, not mine. So we're also, as part of that sort of coupled human and natural system, we have economists and sociologists working on the human side of things. And so one thing they're doing is estimating the value of these orchard nest boxes using regional economic modeling to see, so if we have kestrels deterring fruit-eating birds, what does that save in terms of cherries, and how does that trickle down into the fruit production industry? And then finally, we've expanded this project into the blueberry fields that are in southwestern Michigan. And so we're looking to see, you know, is some of these results, are they applicable to other fruit-growing regions besides cherries? And so with that, I'd just like to acknowledge all of the field assistance I had with monitoring these boxes and thank the various sources of intellectual and funding support. Thank you.